Chapter 11, The Last Lifetime. Better to handle your work in this body, this society, on this earth. A deep remembrance came to me recently while working hard at home vacuuming. That is, this is my last life on earth. All the many issues and conflicts brought with me into this birth, all the frustrations and conflicts of various situations, for all these I have got one last incarnation here to achieve some sort of balance. For very soon this life will be a memory, a vivid parade of images for healing and review on the other side. Of course, it's not quite accurate to say we have got only one chance to deal with all the non-healed experiences of past lives, because many aspects of self that remain out of balance can be reconciled beyond 3D life. Nevertheless, many of the wanderers will soon be going home after what is called harvest, a separation of souls according to their awareness, widely predicted for 2010-2013 AD, see section 2 for more details, but for ET souls in particular, this is a pivotal incarnation for balancing our karmic books. Of course, to discover the unresolved issues carried over from our previous lives, we do not have to look much further than our present-day conflicts. Much of what we consider painful, the areas of life where we feel stuck, the many points of strong emotion, upheaval, confusion, and stagnation, all these experiences point to old unresolved matters. Since the mind of enlightenment, which we seek, already has perfect love, light, ease, and all the virtues we admire, to the extent we do not live this daily, we have got unresolved issues. Fears, doubts, petty irritations, and blocked expression of all sorts point to baggage yet unpacked, dragging limply behind us. For most people, the origin of this is past life experience. For wanderers, these difficulties may also include the residue of centuries of painful adjustment to human society, and this camel will certainly not pass through the eye of the needle on our return back to the home density and cosmic life. It is important to address as many of these issues as we can now. Of course, it is easier said than done. To continue the process of discovery, identifying that which demands final life healing, we can survey the broad field of our personality. We can try to acknowledge the various conflicts and confusions about ourselves that we have acquired from 3D life, most of which come from having forgotten the love light with which we entered the human system. As we do this, our difficulty is probably not finding a particular set of problems, but rather finding those that are most pressing. How do you find your biggest challenge among a crowd of problems? If it's not right here in your face, draping a cloud over everyday life experience, then it's most likely out in the backyard, waiting for you when you can no longer avoid it. Since there are some common issues shared by wanderers and others who follow the spiritual path and seek greater healing, a brief tour of some of these final life matters might be helpful. For many, the greatest conflicts are about path, finding our purpose, coming to define a sense of mission and purpose that we know is essential but cannot quite grasp. For others, it is about relationship, to stay or not to stay, to compromise or hold fast, take a risk or play it safe, trust or remain alone. In other cases, the issue is a bit bigger, the challenge of human society, dealing with all the aggression, mistrust, competition, and materialism out there. And we cannot forget the many problems of self-value, moving beyond self-pity and self-judgment towards a more balanced knowing and appreciation of who we really are, both our strengths and our weaknesses. Dealing with self-valuation, personal relationships, as well as human society, usually challenges us to learn how to welcome others as they are. It requires us to work through and accept our expectations, hurt, blame, loss, and self-complaining. Life on Earth is anything but easy, and for both wanderers and others who are sensitive to inner truth and outer obligation, simply following the line of least resistance is often not enough. If we try to remain in the comfort zone, we will most likely avoid the important conflicts within ourselves and in our relationships. Unfortunately, avoiding pain is not a solution to pain. It may work in the short run, but even then, not too well. A supervisor at my counseling center many years ago used to say, "If you can't see through it, you've got to see it through," which are words to live by. He was pointing out the two basic options we have for dealing with psychological conflict, what can be considered the Buddhist way and the Western way, the mystic and the psychological. The first way demands spiritual vision and gnosis, which means direct realization of things as they are beyond all conceptual levels. Not easy. While the second course calls for full emotional honesty and is more familiar to most of us. In Theravada Buddhist meditation, especially in the forest traditions of Thailand, Burma, and Sri Lanka, the root lineage of all Buddhist schools, the fundamental goal is insight, direct contact and knowledge of self and phenomena as it is, developing a clear vision of that which is beyond change. In Sanskrit terminology, this is considered awareness of sunyata, also called emptiness, impermanence, insubstantiality, and the illusory nature of all that is conditioned, all that arises and passes away. This emptiness can also be defined as, quote, reality, the eternal and changeless creator, the true self, the one, or the absolute, although most Buddhists would also say that all these conceptual terms are illusory as well. Of course, this awareness is beyond all rational thought. If you look long enough with the still vision of a quiet mind, you will see that the only element that does not rise and pass away is the mystery source of who we really are, the root source or true being which inspires our personal awareness. Whether you label it higher self, no self, true mind, or no mind is irrelevant. I promise you, label or no label, this will be the only thing that remains after all else passes away. If you can sustain this type of awareness while dealing with the ordinary challenges of life, both inner emotional process and outer interpersonal affairs, then you are truly seeing through it. If so, then no situation would be emotionally charged, and you would not even use the term life challenges. Everything would be seen as emptiness, God, sacred mystery, or energy in flux. If you're not seeing things this way, then you've got to see it through. This second path of seeing it through is the road most often trod in therapy and personal counseling, a road that rarely approaches the mystic vision described above. It usually does not lead to the realization of emptiness or the illusory nature of thoughts and emotions. Nevertheless, it is still quite useful in dealing with personal affairs of daily life. In general, seeing it through requires consistent self-reflection, carefully observing, accepting, and understanding our habitual patterns of thought, feeling, and behavior. It demands vigilance and a degree of detachment in kindness. An example of this can be found in situations in which we are normally avoiding something, in particular, so-called negative emotions. By seeing it through, we first acknowledge our feelings of fear and insecurity. In situations where we ordinarily get mad, we would recognize the particular thoughts of anger and confusion that usually come first. Nipping matters in the bud, we gain the ability to detach from habitual patterns through unconditional acceptance of our conditioned psychological process. We willingly suffer the brunt of their force without blame or control, and allow ourselves to feel ourselves more completely. In this approach, we also learn the fine art of dialogue, sharing our process with others through greater self-expression, articulating thoughts and feelings in relationships to generate mutual understanding. From both inner and outer work, self-observation and discussion, we slowly become less reactive and our mind becomes more spacious. Events, situations, and people that used to trigger us into reflexive patterns become less charged. At last, we gain a measure of ease. While these two approaches are useful to anyone, they also relate to the challenges of a wanderer's last lifetime. Actually, these two paths help us balance karma, clear dysfunctional patterns, accept our choices, and forgive those of others, all of which lightens the karmic load and helps us regain the awareness with which we came to Earth. Returning to Jesus' metaphor of the camel that must pass through the eye of a needle, there are requirements for returning home. This is because each density represents a certain intensity of light, and our ability to enter those realms depends on our ability to appreciate, enjoy, and integrate that frequency of light energy. The central determinant of who goes where, the where being a dimension or realm of experience in which we take some kind of body form, is simply our state of consciousness. You've got to live the mind of heaven to go to heaven. If we are stuck in emotion or lost in clouds of confusion, we will probably need a bit of healing on the inner planes before going home. Frankly, this kind of soul delay for self-healing is not such a big deal, since life is eternal and we have more than ample resources for the task. But better to handle our work in this body, this society, on this earth. Incarnation here is a tremendous catalyst for growth, far more potent than all the higher realms in which all is love and light. No challenge at all. Giving Caesar his due, another saying attributed to Jesus, referring to the difference between material idolatry and spiritual worship, can also mean healing our own humanity, taking full responsibility for dealing with the personality blockages we have created on Earth while still living on Earth. This is also world service. For most of the wanderers out there, quite soon you will be returning home. In less time than you think, this Earth life will become a dream, a vivid chain of experience rapidly fused in expanding awareness far greater than you've known for a long time. Considering this, reflecting on the many implications, what is your own course of faithful action, your own path of meaning, here and now? Service to all begins at home, and our true home is the kingdom of self, a boundless kingdom of heaven in which we live, move, and have our being. Dear kings and queens, do you still have some royal matters yet undone?